Thank you everyone for coming. Today, it is my pleasure to introduce Yubo Su, who's a postdoc at Princeton University. Before that, he got his PhD at Cornell, working with Don Lai. Yubo has worked in a very wide range of areas in dynamics, and I'm excited to hear what he has to say about tilted stars and exoplanets today. Yubo, please take it away.
Thank you, Yanush, thanks for having me. It's been a lot of fun talking to people already, and I'll be around until the end of the day on Wednesday. So if any of you guys find anything here interesting or just generally want to hang out and chat, I'll be upstairs in room 1404. So I'm here to talk a little bit about tilted stars and exoplanets. And the hope is that over the courses of today's talk, at least everybody will be able to take something away, we'll see how that goes. Yeah, so today I'll be talking primarily about, first just the nomenclature thing. I'll be talking about two different kinds of obliquities, and I'll try to be very careful to distinguish between the two. They kind of split the talk into two halves, so it won't be too ambiguous, hopefully. The first kind of obliquity is the stellar obliquity, and the second kind is the planetary obliquity. So over here I have a very happy sun that is spinning about this orange vertical rotation axis. And then surrounding it, I have our Earth that is orbiting along this blue orbit. And the Earth is spinning, it's bluish green orbit. And the Earth is spinning on this very blue rotation axis here. And I've labeled here this alignment angle between the orbit of the Earth and the spin of the sun, which is about 7 degrees. Over here, this is what we in exoplanets call the stellar obliquity. And then over here, the spin of the Earth is also misaligned from its orbital plane by about 23 degrees, which is what we refer to as the planetary obliquity. Now, this 23 degree obliquity, of course, is very nice for us because it gives us our very nice and temperate seasons. And the obliquity of the sun, on the other hand, is something that is, as far as I can understand, still not, it's large enough to be interesting, but it's not like, hasn't merited like a ton of attention. So I don't know that there's a very definitive reason for it, but it's interesting because it's also non-zero. One slightly interesting thing that I'm not going to mention too much of is that the obliquity of a star is measured with respect to the orbit of a planet. So if you choose different planets, for example, here I've shown Jupiter's orbit, you get a slightly different value for the obliquity, which here, because the orbit of Jupiter is in a slightly different plane, you actually get an obliquity of about 6 degrees. So there's a little bit of ambiguity when we refer to the stellar obliquity of a star. It kind of depends on which planet you measure it with respect to, but you can see that these two values are pretty similar, and that will generally be the case as long as the planets are kind of in the same plane. So that's the nomenclature. The next thing that you might ask is, what do these obliquities look like in the solar system? And here I've pulled up the values, and just broadly what you can see is indeed the stellar obliquity is small but non-zero, and very similar for all of the planets, whereas the planetary obliquities kind of span a pretty wide range of values. There are a couple of obvious oddballs, including Uranus's very famous sideways spinning axis. And so these are kind of the values that I'll be referring to over the course of this talk. Now, let me first talk a little bit more about the stellar obliquity beyond the solar system. So this can be measured, I didn't animate this quite correctly. This can be measured for stars that are not our own sun by something called the Rossiter-McLaughlin effect. Basically, the way that we see planets is a planet, when we look at a star, a planet will transit across the star, blocking some of its light. And then when we see the dip in the total brightness of the star, we observe a planet. However, if we have sufficiently high resolution spectroscopy of the star, then we can actually see that the emission from the star will have a blue-facing side where the stellar fluid is moving towards us, and thus the light is blue-shifted, and the red-shifted side where the star is moving away from us. And so as the planet crosses the disk of the star, what you will see is that the resulting block light, which can be translated to a estimated radio velocity signal, the block light will take on a slightly different shape depending on the orientation that the planet transits. So this is, in some sense, a constraint on what is called what we call the projected stellar obliquity. And it tells you something about the orbit of the planet with respect to the stellar spin projected. Okay, so what do the values that we've measured to date look like? Well, there's a nice plot from this review paper by Simon Albrecht last year that shows the values of the projected obliquity over the past that we've measured to date. There's about 200-ish systems, and you can see that there's a reasonably diverse set of systems that are observed, and including the very famous interesting trend where if you focus on hot Jupiters, the hot Jupiters that orbit full stars tend to have low projected obliquities, whereas the hot Jupiters that orbit hot stars have a wide range of obliquities. So this is kind of what we know about stellar obliquities today.
But what's the bottom plot here?
The bottom plot includes other kinds of planets. So these are warm Jupiters, cold Jupiters, sub-Saturns, and various kinds of
planets. Okay, the top one is just hot.
Yeah. The top plot is limited, restricted to hot Jupiters, for which it's easier to obtain these sorts. Also, please feel free to interrupt me at any point. I'd love to know whether things are making sense as we go. So the reason that we're interested in these stellar obliquity measurements is because there are many interesting trends. This is just a list from the table of contents of this review article showing that there are various different kinds of trends in the stellar obliquity. And the nice thing with these trends is that they might reflect the dynamical history of the system in some way. For example, over here are the histograms that you get for, in this case, 3D obliquity. There's a little bit of a distinction there. But this is the distributions of obliquities that you get via a couple of different processes. And each of these gives different distributions. This is in the particular case of hot Jupiters. But each of these gives a slightly different distribution, which you can compare to the bottommost observed distribution down here. And from that, you can kind of back out which processes are active in these sorts of systems. As you can see, there are a lot of competing dynamical processes that could be responsible for generating this distribution. So being able to develop robust but specific predictions for the stellar obliquity distribution for various kinds of dynamics is useful for understanding what can be at play. Before I finish my introduction, I also want to briefly touch on exoplanet obliquities, since I'll be talking about that a little bit today as well. The world is very different in the world of exoplanet obliquities because they're very hard to measure directly. In fact, Marta Bryant, who is currently a new faculty member at the UT here, led the only two measurements of obliquities for anything remotely planetary mass in the past 2 years. And these are the kind of posteriors that you get. The black line here is the case where you have no signal, and the blue line is the actual observed posterior. So you can see that these constraints are very, very hard to obtain, and the gist of it is just that we don't really have like concrete numbers that we can assign to it necessarily yet. There are definitely prospects for doing this in a couple of other different ways, and there might be clever indirect dynamical ways of inferring exoplanet obliquities as well. One of the reasons that you might be interested in exoplanet obliquities is if you're modeling exoplanet atmospheres, or if you want to, go talk about habitability. For most of these studies, people typically assume that these planets, which are somewhat close into the host stars, are tidally locked. So they have one face of the planet that's always facing the star as the planet rotates around. That's typically assumed due to tidal dissipation. But there can be a couple of ways to, press the wrong button. There can be a couple of ways to break that synchronous rotation. In particular, if the planet is tilted oblique, then the spin rate, of the planet can be subsynchronous, even when it's experiencing tidal dissipation. Yes.
There's no correlation between mass of.
There's no correlation between the mass of the planet and the measure. Are you talking about this expression that I have down here? So this is just if I take the very naive equilibrium tidal expression and I say, let me hold the obliquity of the planet at a particular value theta. With equilibrium weak friction tidal theory, what spin value does the planet go to? And that is not dependent on the planet mass. This is just an asymptotic value, a steady state, this is what we know about exoplanet obliquities, and some of the ways that we can tilt planets. Well, first of all, I guess I should mention, naively, I think you would expect that if I just take a protoplanetary disk and form a planet out of that disk, then the planet should probably, the spin of the planet is probably relatively well aligned with the disk, because I'm just taking some material from the disk. It has the same direction of spinning, right? So you naively would expect planets to form with close to zero obliquities. However, there are a couple of different ways of tilting planets, which most of which were explored in the solar system context, for generating the range of obliquities that you can see over here. Over here. And I'm mostly going to, I'll talk about this a little bit more when I get there. The key interesting thing for us that I'm going to add that's active exoplanetary systems that's not as important in the solar system is the effect of tidal dissipation. This is because exoplanet systems are close to their host star, and most of the solar system planets are quite far away from the sun. Okay, so with that, I'm gonna go ahead and dive into a little bit of theory. This is a famous system called Colombo's top, which is sometimes will be called a cyclic spin orbit resonance. We refer to the equilibrium of it as the Cassini state. So I'm gonna try to give a qualitative overview of some of these dynamics, the dynamics that result in this simplified system, because I should just be able to, because afterwards, when we talk about stellar and planetary obliquities, some of those results will kind of just fall out. And so this is also just one of the simplest ways that you can model the dynamics, the spin dynamics of bodies. And so I wanted to give a brief overview of it first. Okay, so the once upon a time when I was putting together a talk for this, I found out that the origin of these this Colombo's top system actually comes from Cassini's observations of the moon way back in the 17th century, where Cassini stared at the moon for long enough and found that there are three laws that describe the spin behavior, spin dynamics of the moon. One is that the same space of the moon will always face us. The spin rate of the moon is equal to its orbital frequency about the Earth. The second is that even though the moon's spin axis is moving in space, the obliquity of the moon is constant. So the misalignment angle between the moon's spin axis and the orbit of the moon is fixed. Then third, Earth's orbit normal about the sun, the moon's orbit normal about the Earth, and the moon's spin axis remain coplanar, even though there's all this extra precessional motion that's going on. So this was first discovered in 1693 empirically. And then what happened a couple centuries later, Giuseppe Colombo, in a paper titled Cassini's Second and Third Laws, found that, well, the first law is just a simple consequence of tidal dissipation, but the second and third laws actually are quite easy to understand just with gravitational, very simple gravitational dynamics. And he shows that the points that satisfy this are, can be generally referred to as Cassini states. So this model, since Colombo wrote this paper in 1966, has been applied in a variety of, has been studied a lot. It has been applied within the solar system to explain Jupiter and Saturn's obliquities. Also, you can put in some extra fun ingredients and explain Mars's obliquity evolution as well, which turned out to be chaotic. But at the core of Colombo's top are two very simple precessional effects. So here I'm schematically drawing what is happening. I'm going to move away from this picture of the Earth, Sun, Moon. And instead, I'm just going to consider a planet orbiting a host star with a distant perturbing body. This might not be a planet, you know, yeah, this could be a couple. But anyway, we'll consider a planet orbiting on this red axis here with a spin vector, this black vector here, and it has a distant perturbing body that is on the blue orbit here. In such a system, to leading order, there are two effects. One is that the spin axis of the planet will precess about its orbital plane. That's the first equation here. The second is that the orbit of the planet will precess about that of its perturber. These two equations together give rise to the dynamics of Colombo's top. I think that not all of us have thought about cross products since undergrad. So let me draw a quick schematic of what these precessional dynamics look like. And in particular, I'm going to take the system that I drew on a previous slide and look at it from the top down. So basically, in that case, the spin of the planet will tend to precess about the orbit, which is the red dot, while the red dot precesses about the angular momentum axis of the perturber, which is the blue dot here. So this is the top-down view. And immediately, so due to these equations, these equations, which you can derive just by looking at gravity, immediately out pops this Cassini second law, which is that orbits precess in a circle. And then the third law, Cassini's third law, states that Cassini states have to remain coplanar. So somehow we have to find configurations where the blue dot, the red dot, and the black dot remain coplanar as the system undergoes this precession. So that's hopefully that sounds a little bit familiar at this point, because something that I want to point out. Okay, never mind. On the next slide, but okay, an example of configurations where that might be the case are where the blue dot, red dot, and black dot are maybe coplanar here, and then if the precession frequencies are equal, now at a later time they'll both be pointing off the side. There's also, of course, you can construct a case where the spin over the precession frequencies are not equal. So hopefully these geometries will remind some of you of something that you've seen in just simple gravitational orbital systems, which is that I think that these look really like Lagrange points, right? Lagrange points are points in the Earth, Sun-Earth system, where if I put a satellite there, the satellite will co-orbit with the Earth. And so I think that physically speaking, a little piece of intuition that I find helpful whenever we talk about these coplanar Cassini states is that they're almost like Lagrange points of the spin precession. This is kind of just a qualitative picture to keep in mind for what these spin vectors are actually doing in space, but they definitely don't capture the full dynamics. In particular, if we want to understand a little bit more about what's going on, we're going to have to dive into a little bit of algebra here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a quick coordinate transformation to go into the coordinate frame where the red vector and blue vector, which we're processing, will now be fixed. So this is the co-processing frame. And then in this frame, the Cassini states then just become, so in this frame, there's only one evolving vector, which is the black vector S. And in this frame, the Cassini states are just fixed points. And the spin vector in general obeys this equation of motion. So the Cassini states are obtained by just setting this equation of motion equal to zero. What happens when we do that? Well, there's let's first consider two simple limits for now. The first limit, I think it's easy to just start with limits, right? So the first limiting case is where I just cover up the second term here and just look at the first term. So in that case, you can see that there can be four different equilibria, two where S dot L is equal to zero and two where S cross L is equal to zero. And in the coordinate space where L and LP are fixed, these correspond to these four vectors, Cassini states. So this is valid in the limit where alpha, this precession frequency is much larger than G, where I've neglected G basically. So there are four equilibria here. But then interestingly, if I cover up the other term, there are the only possibilities for equilibria are where S is parallel to LP. And so there are only two equilibria in this opposite regime. Yes, Chris, yeah.
This is the outer parity of X in absolute space.
Great question. Yes, I have assumed for simplicity here that the outer, yeah, sufficiently massive. Yeah, you can always just include some extra terms in the precession equations. I think that the dynamics in that case are a little bit harder to interpret, but in principle, that you just write up the equations.
You get the same state.
I think that limit is not has been studied, but the other deviation from this simple Columbus top Hamiltonian can occur if you assume that the spin, maybe you're looking at the spin of a star instead of a planet, in which case the spin and the orbit are coupled. And in that case, it turns out that you can actually get extra equilibria. There can be up to six such Cassini states for the stellar spin. Yeah, so it definitely can change a little bit. And this is just kind of the leading order treatment. Yeah. Okay, so in this other limit, you have two such Cassini states. And so you can see that the number of Cassini states changes depending on the ratios of these two precession frequencies. That already suggests that there might be some interesting dynamics going on. And let me propose these up. The way that these equilibria are linked is a very interesting thing where I've shown over here the plots, the locations of these four Cassini states as a function of the precession frequency. And you can kind of see, you can kind of see what happens is that the orange line and the purple line is a dashed line because it's linearly unstable in that vicinity. These two will annihilate at some critical, they will meet up and annihilate at some critical ratio of precession frequencies. And instead, the new point that takes over is this green Cassini state 2 line. So I think that this picture is kind of helpful just to keep in mind to remember where the various spin equilibria of the system are as a function of changing precession frequency. And then in terms of dynamics, something that can be helpful is to look at the phase-space portraits as a function of phase. So the coordinates that I'm going to adopt are such that the vertical, the y-axis here is cosine beta. Beta is the, in this case, the angle between S and L, which happens to be obliquity. And then the precessional horizontal axis here is the precessional phase, phi. And what you can see is that when g is much less than alpha, there are the four Cassini states. There is a separatrix that pops up within which trajectories. So these are level curves of some conserved quantity. And within the separatrix, your trajectories will tend to what's called the will execute motions such that the value of phi is bounded. And outside of this black line, trajectories will tend to circulate. So that it goes from 0 to 2 pi, 0 to 2 pi, et cetera. And then in the other extreme, there is no such distinction in base space. So when there are only two Cassini states, the separatrix kind of disappears. OK, a lot of math. But this, I'm going to come back to a couple of these ideas over the course of the talk. So hopefully, by the end of it, you'll be a little bit more familiar with it. Instead, what I want to do now is jump into some astrophysics and talk about exciting stellar obliquities with a dissipating protoplanetary disk. So these are the stellar obliquities that I talked about at the start of the talk. Okay, so the gist of what we want to do is this. A lot of stars are found in binaries, and we know that planets form out of protoplanetary disks. So it's a pretty natural idea to ask what happens if I start with a host star and its surrounding protoplanetary disk, which might have embedded planets in it that are either still forming or have already formed, et cetera. And then ask what happens if, in the presence of a distant binary companion, I've put the initial parameters down here. In the presence of this distant binary companion, what happens to the stellar obliquity as the disk dissipates? It's well known from existing studies that as this disk dissipates, what will happen is that the spin vector of the star, this orange vector here, will tend to tilt away from the axis of the disk, which is the red vector here. This corresponds to excitation of this angle beta SL, which is the stellar obliquity. You might assume that at early times they should be pretty well aligned, naively you would think. But as the disk dissipates, it will tend to tilt. And the question that you might want to ask is, if indeed this is such like a prevalent phenomenon, what is the distribution of obliquities that you get via such a process? You should feel free to ask Marco Dici, who's right here in the audience. He actually worked on essentially the same dynamics. Both of us are still working on putting our work together and publishing it, but he worked on it while he was an undergrad at Princeton. So if you have more questions, you should feel free to chat him up. Okay, so with this, with the setup that I've given you over here, the equations of motion you can write down in with the mutual precession, the same mutual precession frequencies that I showed you earlier, mutual precession equations that I showed earlier. And one of the precession frequencies here is going to scale with the mass of the disk. And so what you can see is that as the disk dissipates, one of the ratio of the frequencies will change. And the direction that it changes is such that the system will move from left to right on this plot over here.
That's it. Question, disk mass at what radius?
I'm just gonna take the disk to be treated as a rigid plate. We use a minus one power law profile, and this is just the total disk mass. If you just integrate over the surface density and then scale the surface density such that the total mass is 0.1 times the mass of the star. So we just scaled everything. I left out a bunch of factors over here because for space reasons, this, it does depend on the R out and the R in the disk that you put in as well. Yeah, for sure. But those, in our leading order treatment, none of those will change. We're just gonna assume that the disk, for simplicity, it just homologously dissipates. And spatially homologously dissipates, yeah. There's a small correction here that needs to be added because the angular momentum of the host star spin is non-negligible compared to the disk. So basically, in trying to torque the stellar spin with the disk, there will be a back reaction. So there's a small correction down here due to there just being in the comparable angular momentum case. And I'll show you where that pops into the dynamics later. But basically what's happening here is that, again, we start on the left-hand side of this plot, and as the disk dissipates, we move towards the right. At the start, I told you that you would expect that the stellar spin is well aligned with the disk. And in that case, that puts your stellar spin at an obliquity of zero. This vertical axis here is obliquity. So it starts you out at the location of this blue dot here. And then as the disk dissipates, since you're near an equilibrium, you stay near the equilibrium. This is conservation of space in this area. You stay near the equilibrium, so you'll move along this orange line, this continuous state one, until you hit this this bifurcation over here. And suddenly your track disappears, right? And the question then is, what happens when you hit this critical point? And that's going to be responsible for setting what your final obliquity distribution is, right? In order to understand what happens once you hit this point here, it helps to look at the phase space evolution of the system. Well, okay, first I should show that as I dissipate my disk with a characteristic lifetime of omega year, I'm just going to exponentially lose the disk mass. You can see that it indeed starts the blue line. This is a plot of the obliquity as a function of time. And you can see indeed that the obliquity starts at zero. And then at here, which is where the frequencies cross, is where the obliquity suddenly gets excited. Down here, I'm showing the precession frequencies. You can see that indeed is where they cross, that you get obliquity excitation, this blue line here. And the blue and red dots on these two plots are meant to match. Now, to understand what happens to the obliquity at this point and how we can predict it, it helps to go back to the phase space evolution of the system. Over here on the left-hand side is the initial condition where the disk is very massive. I have all four of my Cassini states. And then in the intermediate regime is where I'm going to have these two points, these two Cassini states mutually annihilate. That's where the red dot is here. So you can see that the two Cassini states are the orange dot, which is represents this orange trajectory, the purple cross, which represents the unstable Cassini state will come down. And so what happens is my spin has been chilling on top of the orange dot as the disk dissipates from right to left to right, and then it annihilates. And so it loses loses track of the equilibrium that it's trying to follow. And it turns out that the resulting track that it starts to move on instead is given by this black dashed line in the rightmost plot, where the shaded areas between the middle plot and the rightmost black rightmost plot are equal. Basically, the spin was trying to follow the orange Cassini state one, and then it gets ejected. And the only trajectory that can follow is the bottom leg of the separatrix. And so the shaded areas are equal. It's definitely wacky, but there's no equilibrium left for it to follow. So that's the only trajectory that it can be sent on. Yeah. And then it turns out that for Colombo's top, people have calculated this area. And so you can back out you can back out the final orientations of the angles. And over here, there are three vectors, so there are three angles. In each of these plots, the red lines are taken from numerical integrations of the ODEs that I showed you. The black dashed line is the very naive estimate that you get out of just the Colombo's top model, which this area has been known for 35 years now. And then the blue solid line is a small correction that takes into account this finite angular momentum term that I was telling you about earlier. So there's a small correction for small angles because the angular momentum is there's limited angular momentum budget, and there's also a small correction in the center of which I had it. So we can understand one last thing then is this is all good and all, but I think that it's not necessarily the easiest to consume. The easiest thing to understand is what is the resulting distribution of obliquities. Maybe we can assume that the orientation of the disk and the binary plane, they don't know anything about each other, they're pretty far away. So maybe we can just say that they're isotropically distributed for simplicity. So then that gives you a distribution of obliquities, which is going to be right here. The distribution, the red histogram is taken from numerical integrations. The black dashed and blue solid lines are taken from these two analytical models. And you can see that the agreement is not pristine, but it's pretty good. These peaks are spurious and they kind of depend on when you end the simulation at. And so I wouldn't take them too seriously. I've taken a look at this plot for different ending times and we have different, these large peaks over here are are temporary, but the overall distribution where the obliquity is broadly distributed between about 60 and 180 degrees is robust, and we understand exactly why that is by simply just looking at Columbus. It just popped out of Columbus top, basically. And we, in a paper that has been published, we show that this has implications for the obliquity distribution that you get via for hot Jupiters from the highest interest migration. That's just a quick plug. Okay, so this is kind of the main takeaway for this part of the talk, but I think that there are a lot of caveats that you can imagine. And in particular, I think that a lot of people will be concerned about our disk model. And so one of the things that we tried was we said, well, protoplanetary disks, they don't really just rigidly dissipate in place. The location where the disk is dissipating, the rate at which you're losing mass depends on where you are in the disk. In particular, so typically we assume that the disks are rigid because of this, because bending waves, basically small warps in the disk, propagate very rapidly and damp. And so that maintains the rigidity of the disk. This is a result that JJ Zanazzi, who was here until I think like last year or so, worked out with my advisor Don Lai in 2018. But if a disk has a complete gap, of course, then there can't be any wave propagation between these two. And so there's no bending wave propagation. And so we wondered, you know, if we, so a gap can form naturally during the dissipation of both pair and your disk because the ultraviolet photons being emitted by the star have a characteristic radius of about 1 AU where the disk is most efficiently photoevaporated. And when this happens, there will be an inner disk that is mostly hydrodynamically decoupled from the outer disk. The inner disk will dissipate very rapidly on a time scale of about 0.1 megayears. These are called transitional disks, and such transition disks have been observed. I don't know whether the statistic has been updated, but it's somewhere around 10% of systems. And so the upshot of this is that if you plug this disk physics in, maybe you get something different for planets that are interior to this gap, because they see very different physics. And so this was the sort of thing that we try to explore next.
So you bottom line is you need a finding of binary companion to get a solid equivalent.
It's necessary for this channel. Of course, there are different ways that you can do it, right? But yeah, for this channel that we're proposing here, we're trying to better characterize if you do have a binary companion, what sorts of obliquity excitation you get. It's worth saying I've been floating this idea around for a bit, and I haven't gotten a chance to check it too carefully yet, but it only takes a couple of mega years for the obliquity to be excited, whereas I think birth cluster lifetimes are a little bit longer. So I think that since there is evidence of binaries being dissolved in the birth cluster, and those should preferentially be these relatively wider binaries, I had an idea that maybe the dissolution of the birth cluster can unbind the binary after the obliquity excitation. Yes, it does. Yes, that's definitely right. I used my fiducial parameters. My fiducial parameter puts the binary separation at 300 AU. If you were too close, you'd start to truncate the disk, which is not great for the precession frequencies crossing. And if you're too far away, then you just never really have an effect. So 300, I checked a couple of times. And so basically between 200 and 500 AU is definitely going to be secure, and you probably have a little bit of leeway on either side, depending on what mass ratio you use, what disk parameters you use, et cetera. Okay, so we can ask what happens for these transition disks and see whether this changes the obliquity excitation at all. The resulting equations are written over here on the left, and I hope I can convince you that this is not entirely trivial to analyze. This is four mutually precessing vectors, where there's a spin vector, there's an inner disk with an embedded planet, there's an outer disk, the green arrow here, and there's a distant binary companion. I've put up the fiducial parameters here in case people are interested. But four vectors is a lot of vectors, and I've only told you how to work with Columbus top, which has three vectors. So the way that we chose to look at this analysis was basically that there should be two limiting cases. The inner disk is hard to treat, so maybe the inner disk is, we can treat it as being either well coupled to the star or to the outer disk, gravitationally well coupled. And in those two cases, of course, if the disk is always well coupled to the star, then they will always intersect in the same plane. You'll never get a new obliquity excitation. And if you're coupled to the outer disk, well, the outer disk does fun things, so you get obliquity excitation. And wait, how did this seem so far? Okay, this is the slide that I meant to be on. Sorry, that's spoiler alert. So this is the obliquity excitation with this broken planetary disk. I've put in a super Earth at a semi-major axis of anywhere between 0.1 to 0.4 AU. This top plot here is the final obliquity as a function of the location of the planet. And you can see that within about 0.25 AU, the final obliquity is zero. Outside of about 0.25 AU, the planet obliquity is over distributed over a wide range. The distribution I've shown up here for just a particular value of the planet semi-major axis, you can see that it's broadly prograde. And I told you that there's two different ways that you can think about this four vector problem. Indeed, if the over here on the vertical axis is some quantity that measures the coupling of the inner disk, the relative coupling strength of the inner disk. Below the black dashed line, the inner disk is well coupled to the host star. Above the black dashed line, roughly, the inner disk is well coupled to the outer disk. And indeed, that kind of demarcates the transition between well-aligned and non-well-aligned systems. The interesting thing that we found while working through this is that if you change the planet's mass, for example, if you put a warm Jupiter, this is over 100 times more massive than the super Earth that I put in. I put it in also at the same semi-major axis. The obliquity cutoff here doesn't really seem to change very much. And so this transition is actually mass independent. And if you work through those equations that I showed you earlier, it turns out that you can kind of show that this is the case for the fiducial parameters that I put up. So it's interesting. The obliquity distribution can be pretty similar, even though these planets are dramatically different masses. So this is kind of what I wanted to tell you about this stellar obliquity excitation. So the setup that I put up before is that I have a star with its surrounding protoplanetary disk and an embedded planet and a distant binary companion. I initially start with a zero stellar obliquity, and after the disk dissipates, what I kind of find is that cool planets have preferentially retrograde stellar obliquities, as shown over here. This is able to be well understood. And warm planets, regardless of mass, may be well aligned within 0.25 AU and broadly prograde outside of that. This bottom bullet point depends on the disk physics a little bit, so there's a little bit of leeway that you can do there to try to there's some comparison that we can make with the observed trends, which I'm not going to go into here. But by the time that this is all written up, it will definitely be there. Does anybody have any questions before I move on to talk about planets? Yes, Ian? The solar system. So, I mean, the solar system is a very biased system, right? And so
we don't have a binary companion.
Yeah, exactly. We don't have a binary companion.
But still. Sorry,
no.
Which is special.
Janusz, did you have a question?
So this gives the predictions for the stellar obliquity with respect to the planet's orbit.
Yeah,
sure. Does it give predictions for the stellar obliquity with respect to the binary?
Yes, great question. Yeah, actually it does. It makes a much tighter prediction. In fact, if I go back to showing, so this is something that I'm looking to test, hoping to test with somebody who can teach me how to do it. If you look up here, this top panel here is the misalignment angle between the spin axis and the binary axis. Bottom plot is for the stellar obliquities. You see that the obliquities are distributed over a wide range, so it's a little bit hard to ensure and characterize. But the top plot is actually extremely tight. So if we could get good measurements, so this is a very hard measurement to make, of course, the misalignment angle between the spin and the distant binary companion. But we might be able to do it at some population slash statistical level. I've been thinking about this a little bit. And that would be a very concrete prediction. Yes, good point. Yes. Yes.
You can apply different models to that problem on the planet on the bottom.
Different models on the right? What kinds of different models? Yeah. Do you mean different parameters, for example? Or?
Well, because the graph is steeper. The second one is actually linear multiplied with cusp. Yeah.
Sorry, I think I didn't leave a schematic here representing the angles. These are, so there are three vectors in the system, and these are the three pairwise angles. Spin, LP, and L. Yes, these are the mutual. So this is the spin binary axis, this is the orbit binary axis, and this is the spin orbit misalignment. Yeah. So these are all for the same set of integrations. It's just different different angles. Yeah. Sam, do you have one?
Just make sure nothing about this depends, or tilting the star anyway, doesn't depend on the planet actually. It's just causing the precession of the star.
So that's also, that's an interesting question. For these cold planets, it turns out that is, broadly speaking, the case. For planets that are sufficiently close into their host stars, for example, JJ also looked at this a couple years back. For example, if you imagine that a hot Jupiter formed in situ, basically what happens as the disk dissipates is that the stellar spin starts out being very strongly coupled to the disk, and then it's strongly coupled to the planet, and never does the binary companion enter into the equation at all. Because basically the precession frequency has to smoothly transition between the disk star and the planet star. So if the planet is sufficiently close in, then these dynamics break down. And you can check where that happens as a function of planet mass. For hot Jupiter, it happens at about 0.25 AU. For super Earth, it happens closer to about 0.08.
You probably need to start with planets to test this binary.
Yes, you do not. Yes, exactly. Exactly, yeah, for the spin binary. So if you just observe them, so the idea that we had was you can look into maybe like photometric rotation rates, line broadening, and then also like you have some orbit constraints from Gaia. And so you might be able to, that's not a full constraint, but you might be able to start putting some statistics. There might be some statistics. Yeah, but that's exactly right. You don't need a planet to get this topmost plot at all. Anybody have any other questions?
Going back to previous questions. You think maybe even when the stars were already
I tried with some parameters. I don't know whether they're very good ones, but for the parameters that I tried, I found that the lifetimes of roughly 300 AU binaries in some birth cluster, around 10^3, 10^4 per cubic parsec. I think I was finding lifetimes of around 20 megayears. That's like how often you expect collision, a flyby of order 300 AU. I might have done it wrong. I'd be happy to look into that in a little bit more detail later. Okay. So with my remaining time, that's about planet obliquities, and that's random missing slide. Okay, now I'll briefly talk a little bit about some of my work with planetary obliquities, completely changing the context, but this is still spin dynamics, still from those up. Hopefully some of the ideas that I laid out at the start will still percolate through. Okay. Oops, one slide too many. Oh, that's what happened. Okay, sorry. I guess I accidentally dragged this out of order. So this is the slide that was supposed to be immediately after that. I want to talk a little bit about planetary obliquities in the presence of tidal dissipation. And in particular, over here is a plot of all of the exoplanets that we've found so far as of yesterday. And you can see that there are a couple of broad clumps over here. This is the vertical axis here is the mass of the planet. Horizontal axis here is the location of the planets. I've shown the Earth and Jupiter and for reference, but there's a population of planets down here that are these close in super Earth. So they have mass of them a little bit more than the Earth, and they're substantially colluding. And for these close in super Earths, the time scale over which you expect the spin of the planet to evolve due to tides, either the spin orientation or the spin rate, is given by this expression here. And basically, it's about 30 million years conditional on a couple of parameters. This is for a super Earth at 0.4 AU, I should point out. So this is actually reasonably far out. And so this is, of course, younger than the age of most planetary systems that we observe. So what you should be looking for planetary obliquities of these close-in super Earths are states that are tidally stable. The stable to tidal dissipation, obliquities are stable to tidal dissipation. Now, super Earths are typically thought to be formed via late stage giant impacts. And so you can imagine that if I smash two rocks together, the final spin, that object has no preferred orientation. So I'm just going to say that the initial spin orientation is random. And then I'm going to ask if I turn the crank on tidal dissipation, What are the final liquid heat release? That's the question that I want to answer. Let me go back to where I was supposed to be in the presentation. I don't know how I got dragged out of order. Sorry about that. Okay, so let me just paint a picture with a coordinate space that I'm going to use a couple of times in the presence of just tidal dissipation. This vertical axis here is the obliquity of the planet. Again, remember that the Earth's obliquity is 20 odd degrees here. And the horizontal axis here is the spin rate of the planet divided by its orbital frequency. So, in the presence of tidal dissipation, the spin rate of the planet will match the orbit rate. So it's going to be pushed onto 1.0, horizontally pushed to 1.0. It turns out that it's not exactly one. The expression that I showed earlier shows that weak tidal friction pushes you onto this black line here. Tides also cause obliquity damping, which generally means that points anywhere up here will generally be pushed down to tidally damped to an obliquity of zero. And so what you end up with is that with just tides, all super Earths should end up at spin orbit synchronization and zero obliquity. This is what would happen if the super Earth were alone. However, it was generally found that a lot of super Earths are in systems where they have distant cold Jupiter companions. So it's found to be roughly 90%. Though, as I understand it, there are recent observational studies that suggest that maybe this 90% is not quite that high, but it's still a substantial fraction. I think like they're still coming up many tens of percent. So in such a system, I have a super Earth that is spinning, it's orbiting, and it's processing about the orbit of a cold Jupiter. This, I have three vectors on the slide, so we're going to apply the Columbus top to it. Okay, so how does that? Okay, so let me first quick interlude how the Columbus top changes in the presence of tidal dissipation. Well, it turns out that there are a couple of these Cassini states that I was showing you earlier are unstable in the presence of tides. So over here, this is the same plot of the Cassini states with the obliquities as a function of the precession frequencies. However, you can see that now with this blue line here, I've changed it to a dashed line because it's unstable to tidal dissipation. Tides will drive you away from anti-alignment. Cassini state 4 remains stable. However, the green line here, Cassini state 2, and the orange line here, Cassini state 1, are both tidally stable. And so you can see that if I somehow manage to be captured into Cassini state 2 at a precession frequency, at like maybe this point right here, for example, a frequency of about like Geode alpha 10 to the minus 1, then I'll be trapped with an obliquity of 80 odd degrees or so, and that will be stable to tidal dissipation. Tides cannot kick me away and drive me down to zero. So that's why Cassini states are interesting in the story of planetary obliquities with tidal dissipation. So let me go back to that coordinate space that I was, so of course then that means that at late times, because my system is dissipative, I can only end up in either Cassini state 1 or Cassini state 2. If I'm anywhere else, it's not in equilibrium. And because my system is dissipative, I have to just damp to an equilibrium, right? Venus is an interesting case. As far as I understand, Venus is kept at this anti-aligned state due to thermal tides, and I don't have that modeled here explicitly. So that's what I would expect to happen. Yeah, though it is worth mentioning that tidal dissipation is very, very slow when you're at like 100, when you're near 180 degrees. The theta dot scales with like sine theta or so, right? So if you're sufficiently near 180, then I think that is quite hard to get ejected. But in theory, without the thermal tides, the obliquity should be getting down to zero. Okay, now let me go back to this plot, this coordinate space that I was showing you earlier, where vertical axis again is the obliquity, horizontal axis here is the spin rate. My tidal dissipation is still acting, but I've drawn now two extra lines for the two Cassini states, the orange lines and the green lines here. The Cassini states depend on the spin rate of the planet because the spin rate of the planet sets the oblateness, and the oblateness is what causes the precession. Anyway, yeah, so the Cassini state obliquities depend, vary horizontally. What's worth noting is that at the intersections of these Cassini states with the black line here, the spin rate derivative is equal to zero because it's at equilibrium of the equilibrium tides. And then the vertical axis is stabilized because we're in a time degree stable Cassini state. So if a planet ever makes it into this green circle dot or this orange circle dot, then the planet will stay there in for a very long time, even if it's experiencing tidal dissipation. I have a quick question on Zoom asking, how large are the eccentricities of the orbits that cause orbital precession? So even, that's a good question. So even with circular orbits, if they start out with some amount of mutual inclination, if they're misaligned a little bit, then their inclinations will tend to precess. So any amount of inclination will generate some amount of precession. The precession frequency does, the leading order not depend on. So, yeah. No, so you would experience tidal heating, but you would experience this is an idea that was has been explored in recent years by Sarah Mulholland and Greg Laughlin. So you would experience enhanced tidal heating up here, but your obliquity would be trapped there until basically your semi-major axis starts beginning to change because of tidal dissipation. So the way that this picture starts to break down. Yeah. So that's a very good question. There's been a little bit of back and forth on that. I think the first word on this was by Dan Fabricate and Jeremy Goodman in 2007. They said that obliquity tides, basically, if you're trapped here and you have enhanced tidal dissipation, it can't be responsible for inflating hot Jupiters because the required amount of dissipation is so large that it actually makes this state unstable. You can show that if the tidal dissipation is too strong, then the Cassini state disappears. I think that people have explored that parameter space a couple of times. In any case, it's definitely a very tight constraint. It's a very small region of parameter space, even if it even exists. But it has been explored.
Well, okay, but
yeah.
You reach the green line, you are saying you move along the green line to the located line.
Perfect question. So these are a couple of example trajectories where the crosses are various initial conditions. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, and then I also added a 5 and a 6 down here that are subsynchronously rotating just for completeness. So yeah, what we find is that if you start with an initial condition maybe up here at an obliquity of 120 degrees, start tidally damping and you start moving down, you will encounter the, in phase basis, the separate matrix, but you will encounter Cassini state 2, and then you will either skip over it, in which case you go straight to Cassini state 1, tidal Cassini equilibrium 2, or you will get captured into the resonant and you will be brought to tidal Cassini equilibrium 2. But so that is a probabilistic process. I'm sorry?
What are the relevant
probabilities? Great question. I thought, no, this is perfect. So that means I can answer it in the course of the talk. So these are some initial conditions, and I just want to point out that, yeah, indeed, all these initial conditions do converge to one of the tidal Cassini. And so the question is exactly then, if I only have two possible end states, what are their relative probabilities? I'm going to skip over this slide for time's sake. But basically, yeah, so this is a, on the horizontal axis here is a parameter eta sync, which is if the ratio of precession frequencies at spin orbit sync compensation. But basically, you can think of it as in the super Earth cold Jupiter system, towards the left is corresponds to a more distant cold Jupiter, and towards the right is a closer in one. The top plot here shows the obliquities of the two tidal Cassini equilibria. The bottom plot here shows the probability of being captured into the high obliquity TCE2. For my fiducial super cold Jupiter system, this eta sync parameter value is 0.3. And so the way to read this is at 0.3, I come up here and I look on the top plot and I see that there are two TCEs. One is at about 60 degrees, the other is about 10. And the probability of being in the 60 degree one is about 30%. And these blue and red dashed lines are analytical estimates that we can develop because it was a lot of fun. We worked out the probability of separate of resonance capture, et cetera, for this problem. It's actually resonance capture in a dissipative system, which I think is actually very similar to the non-dissipative calculation, but people don't seem to have, at least in planetary dynamics books, it's not explicitly pointed out. So it's actually pretty strict. It's actually pretty easy to do as well. You can calculate these probabilities of being captured into either of these two open
spaces. Is this a deterministic process? Since you start off with the planet and certain obliquity,
yeah,
other than the certain vague, guaranteed to be one of these end states, or
maybe I should back to the plot that I skipped. No, that's perfect. So this is The way that this plot works is the vertical axis here is the, so this is the initial planet obliquity. This is the initial phi precessional phase, where again, the coordinates I've shown you over here, theta is the initial obliquity, phi is the vertical axis. For each of these points, I pick a point, I integrate it forward in time with tidal dissipation, and I ask, does it end up at TC, tidal cosine equilibrium 1, or tidal cosine equilibrium 2? For a given point, the evolution is deterministic. And moreover, in phase space, the everything that is above the separatrix here, it converges to TCE1, which is the low obliquity plot point, and that's at the top. Here it corresponds to zero obliquity. Everything inside the separatrix goes to the high obliquity TCE2, which is at the center of the separatrix. Everything down here, the evolution is deterministic, but is effectively probabilistic because the manifolds that go to go to one or the other equilibrium are extremely tightly spaced. It's very sensitively dependent on the initial phase. I know that I'm out of time, and so I'll just let me just go straight to the big summary that I wanted to bring up. So again, I talked a little bit today about Cassini states, and I think the point that I want to make is that Cassini states are the coprocessing equilibria of this mutually processing system. The fact that it's nonlinear gives you a changing number of equilibria, which gives you a lot of interesting dynamics. I then applied this to stellar liquidity evolution with a dissipating protoplanetary disk. And generally, that leads to large preferentially retrograde obliquities. But if you look at transition disks, broken protoplanetary disks, that can change this behavior in the case of warm planets. Over here on this state diagram over here, bullet point 2 corresponds to the case where my system is evolving from left to right. So you evolve and lose Cassini state 1. And then case 3 down here are planetary obliquities in the presence of tidal dissipation. You can end, I argue that you can end up with large obliquities even with tidal dissipation because you get captured into this tidal dissipation state 2. And that corresponds to the case where in this plot I have an tidally dissipating downwards. So yeah, that's all that I really wanted to mention today. I'm just going to advertise that I also think a lot of LIGO sources about tides, giant oscillations, and I'll be up in room 1404 if and you guys want to talk. I do have a schedule as well if you guys want to put your names down. Yeah, thanks for listening.
So if you have a star spinning down, which you change the radius.
Yes.
And you have a same picture hold, or is it?
Very good question. Actually, that was something that Cassandra Anderson and Dong explored a couple of years back, where if you have a star that's undergoing magnetic breaking, how does that change the stellar obliquity? And that does also, it's but that's the nice thing, I think, with having this portion up, is that that also results in the exact same evolution where the spin orbit coupling gets weaker. So you're moving along to Cassini state 1, and then you get ejected, and you experience these large scale oscillations. Yeah, so you end up with some very, very similar dynamics in that case. It's slightly different because the you have some angular momentum budget constraints. But yeah, I can send you the paper if you're interested.
One problem you didn't say the electrons.
Oh, which
one in terms of mass and distance? The long formula.
Oh, the long formula. That's in our paper. Let me go back. I don't have the reference to the paper, but yes, this formula right here. Yeah, this is in the one of my papers with Dong Lai in 2022. Yeah, I guess I probably should have put the reference somewhere, but yeah. Yes.
Do you have an estimate for where the thermal tides are going to dominate over these other things?
Oh, that's interesting. No, I personally haven't looked at that. I know that there are some groups based out of France that have been looking into incorporating thermal tides as well as like more self-consistent tidal models. There was a recent study that looked into this for rocky planet rheologies. I didn't go through the paper in complete detail, but based on the plots, it seemed like the gravitational spin orbit resonances are mostly still dominant over the thermal tides for, I think that most of the planet regime that they were considering, which I think is like the standard like exoplanet regime, but I'd have to go back and double check, yeah.
Okay.
There are people working on this, though. Yeah, I guess that's why. That's why. Chris, okay, yeah.
What's the most interesting point you had to skip
over? So I guess this is the one that I'm currently most excited about, this work that I'm doing with Henry, who is an undergraduate at Princeton right now. Basically, what we tried was instead of, I didn't go too much into detail here, but we were working in our study with fluid bodies. So the J2 of the planet, the oblateness, scales with the spin rate of the planet. But alternatively, you can just imagine a world where the planet is just a rigid rock. I throw a rock up in space and I let it gravitationally interact. Basically what happens is in the same coordinate space that I was showing you with obliquity here, spin rate here, I showed over here that with these initial conditions starting to cross, they converge to these two tidal Cassini equilibria. We also tried with just these rocky planets. And for these rocky planets, they start as red dots and they tidally dissipate. But it seems like they're hitting some sort of a resonance at 2-to-1, the 2-to-1 spin orbit ratio and the 1-to-1 spin orbit ratio, such that nothing actually ends up at this high liquidity TCE2 here. So we're still checking the algebra of this, making sure that the thing is correct, trying to understand analytically where this is coming from. If this holds up, then that suggests that for rocky planets, you can't nearly as easily be captured into these tidal liquidity states. And since super Earths are being found to be quite dense these days, we think that this might actually be a better model for super Earths.
Well, actually, this was connected with a question I had in mind.
That,
but, you know, when you are dealing with super Earths, and what extent is the solid crust quite a long? It's just a small fraction.
Yeah. That I have to admit, I have not thought about.
And even that direction can't sustain too much stress. Well, that's the thing.
Yeah.
But now it's...
I know that JJ looked into whether these sorts of interactions can initiate plate tectonics, I think. And there was a big paper that he put out, but I'm not familiar enough with the contents. But that's something to check. What statistics govern the inner core of exoplanets on Zoom? What statistics govern the inner core of exoplanets? I think that this is very up in the air right now, but I think the general sense for us is just that if you we can measure the densities of these planets, and so if the densities are consistent with mostly rocky or icy compositions, then we think that the cores of the exoplanets are probably accordingly rocky or icy as well. Yeah. Okay, I think I'm over time by now, quite over time, but thank you so much for all the questions and thanks for listening.